So we have Karis here who plays Dysart. We're going to just interview her a little bit and it will be useful for you to find out as much as you can. You don't have to stick to the stuff about her character. You can also branch out into other areas of the play if you're confused about it. Set design and lighting design and weird bits of sound that shouldn't be in it. You can address those questions to me in a minute. Off you go. Who wants to ask a question? Yes?
Did he have sex with a horse?
No.
No, he didn't. Shall I explain this?
You can give it a go if you like.
No. He had, like, he saw the horse as kind of his god, and the horses were like the thing he worshipped, and he believed his god lived inside them. And so he just really loved them, and he believed they were always watching him and judging him. And when he tried to have sex with Jill, he felt bad because he thought he was going against what his god wanted him to do, which is why he tried to then blind all the horses, because he was trying to stop his god from seeing him.
Which country was it set in?
God.
Good question.
Just... I don't think it was very... Well, yeah, England, because there's a bit where they're like, it's...
It's British.
English.
Yeah, yeah, no, it is. It is.
Just here.
Don't be embarrassed, guys.
Does your character eventually end up seeing the X, the god?
The last monologue that I have, I sort of say that my last line is, there's now a chain in my mouth and it never comes out. But so, in the last monologue, I kind of talk about how it's really hard to explain. While I've been working with Alan, I've kind of listened to his views on God, and I don't really share his belief totally, but I kind of see where he's coming from. The whole time I'm talking about, in a few of my monologues, I talk about the idea that if I make him better, I'm kind of taking a part of him away from him to make him normal and just like everyone else, and that maybe I shouldn't do that. And so I think he doesn't
envy his worship.
Yeah, I don't think he sees Ekris, but I think he understands him, kind of.
She.
Who's the author? Who wrote Ekris, and what form did he write in? I.e., play, book.
It's written by Peter Schaefer, and he wrote it as a play.
What were you going to ask, Nicole?
I was going to ask the same thing as Megan, how did your character see Ekris, towards the end, did you start to believe it?
Just kind of an answer. When you were watching it, did you feel that she did?
Yeah. Kind of, yeah.
Does that mean that you felt that Ekris was a real thing, or do you feel that it was a shared delusion, or shared worship?
I thought it was kind of I don't know how to explain it, because you know in depth how much he believes and how he kind of views it, you kind of started to feel the same about it.
I think that's good. I think because there's all the bits where actually there's the bit where Dysart's kiss anyone and I will see you lie with anyone, and he sort of takes on the voice of Ekris. So I think she does really get to understand Ekris and what Ekris is supposed to be like, and probably in a way does end up believing in parts of it because of how well she knows it.
Something you should be aware of as well, although we did the whole play, but we did edit parts of it out, and there are a number of speeches in there, aren't there, which Dysart has, which maybe clarify his thoughts on it a bit, which you're aware of because you've studied, but maybe aren't there. Go on.
You know in the bits where, if you weren't on the stage, acting, you would, you're on the outside, and then it was kind of they had small reactions to what was going on, how come you didn't have?
The people around the outside were supposed to be patients in the ward that Alan was on, and the idea of us sort of drawing and painting and stuff was we were kind of in an art therapy kind of lesson, and there was a sign on the wall that said art therapy and stuff, and then when we reacted we were sort of mimicking the reactions of Alan, and we were showing how he was feeling, but we were sort of amplifying it by having everyone else doing it as well.
You know, in the dream that Alan has,
yeah,
are you like the chorus around the outside? Are you the horses? Like Alan's dream that he's, they're coming after him after he's playing with them.
The dream that he has where we all put hands on his face.
Yeah.
Yeah,
worth it. Hmm. We never really established that they were specifically horses as such, but I think it was very much about his desire to make contact, and he'd made contact with horses. I don't know if you noticed, but we had a lot of things where faces were being touched, and that's a kind of theme or motive throughout it. This idea of wanting contact. Because he never gets really any contact except with Equus throughout the piece. So I didn't direct you guys to be horses. Although there were some rehearsals where they spent like 3 hours being horses, but that wasn't at that point.
When you had your first dream, what was that about? Because you were sacrificing people?
Yeah. So it was kind of, he was meant to be sacrificing children. So, Dysart's, he's in Greece, and like all the way through, there was a lot of bits that we'd cut out that kind of make it more obvious, but Dysart's got a bit of an obsession with Greece and Greek mythology and just wants to be in Greece like all the time. And so it's set in like this place that he loves, and then he's like cutting up the children, and he's doing it, yeah, he's got a mask on, and then when the mask comes off, he stops doing it, and I kind of saw it's him. When he was cutting them up, it kind of felt like the idea that he was cutting away bits of them that matter to them. But because it was portrayed in such a gory way, it kind of showed the way he really felt about his job. Like, he doesn't feel like he's doing something good and making them better. He kind of doubts if that's really what he's doing, if really he's, you know, cutting away bits of them up that are, like, essential to making them who they are.
Oh, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
So if he is sacrificing, who is he sacrificing to? Or four? You can come back to me on that if you like. But it's an interesting one, isn't it?
Yeah. I'll think about it.
Maybe blog it. It's an interesting
one. When he felt bad for himself, instead of like blinding the horses, could he like talk to one of them and see if it was okay instead?
Yeah. You didn't see the play, did you?
No.
But you're picking up on it. Okay, good. Come on.
Picking up on it.
Well, he kind of felt like the horses, he didn't really feel able to talk to them because he felt like all of the horses were God. And, you know, it's pretty big, just going up to God and being like, hey, listen, you know, just chill out. So I think he was so intimidated, and he was in this some
and
state.
He was angry at that point as well, weren't
yeah.
they? Because God was angry with him, so.
And he felt sort of scared. And if there was this gigantic monster coming at you, you wouldn't feel comfortable enough to just be like, hey, stop, let's have a chat. So he just resorted to the violence.
Okay. Right, how did Peter Schreiber end the play? Did he end it like how you lot ended it, or
yeah.
Did the parents not find out why he blinded the horses?
No, it ends the way we ended it. But in the last monologue that Dysart has, he kind of hints at he says stuff like, you know, you are going to get better and it's going to take a while and you'll never have to see Equus again. So kind of the idea, and then he talks about how, you know, it never stops for him and there's always this chain in his mouth, and I kind of get the feeling that at the end, he restores Alan to being, like, normal and gets rid of his problems, and, like, he says it'll take a while, but eventually it probably happens. But the burdens that Alan had are kind of put onto Dysart at the end, mm-hmm. and he's the one who's burdened with this Equus god at the end of it.
Are there, like, do you think there are any specific events in Alan's childhood that lead to his, like, condition?
I think that it's unintentionally, but I do blame his parents, I think, quite a lot for what happened to him, because they just never agreed, and being in a household where both your parents are constantly, you know, at each other and just disagreeing would be really sort of quite a damaging way to grow up. And I also think, you know, his dad, like, generally seeming to provoke him again, like pulling him off the horse and then tearing down the picture that he loved and stuff. His dad always seemed to take away from him things that, like, the sort of joy, and then horses seemed to be the thing that gave it back to him, I guess. Like, when he was on the horse, he was happy, and his dad was the one who ruined that. And when he had his picture on his wall, he was happy, and then his dad tore it down, but a horse replaced it, and that made him happy. So I think he always saw them as this thing, this, you know, positive thing that would make him happier. And so, yeah.
Do you think that he wanted to, like, see Equus?
Alan?
Yeah.
I think at first he probably liked having Equus there. Like, it talks about when he's 12 years old and he's in his room and stuff. That seems to be quite a voluntary thing he did when he, like, worshipped him, but I think it probably got a bit overpowering. And, like, when it was at the point where he, you know, was in the stable and he wanted to be with Jill, but he said, like, I couldn't see her. And it was just, all he could see was this garden. It was suddenly taking over every part of his being. I think he didn't like totally losing control. It stopped being sort of him giving to Equus because he wanted to, and started being like Equus taking him totally. And he didn't like that.
I wasn't really sure. Is, like, Equus, like, one specific person, or is it one person, horse? Or is it in, like, all the other horses?
It's meant to run through every horse, because there are, like, a couple of lines that are meant to clarify it. So he's like, does it live in all horses, or do you ride one horse in particular? And he's like, no, it's just in all horses, which is why he finds, like, all six of them instead of it just being this one horse. But there is one called Nugget that's referenced more than any of the others in the play, but it's supposed to just live in every horse. Yeah.
Do you think that your character was, like, found, like, Alan's, like, story kind of more, like, that, like, affected her more than other stories, or is it just because we, like, focused on that in the play?
I think it did, because it's quite a shocking story, because Dysart's supposed to be, like, a child psychiatrist. And he talks about, at the start, he talks about two cases that he's dealt with that day, which is a 15-year-old schizophrenic and a girl thrashed into catatonia by her father. And, you know, they're, like, pretty bad, but I guess you kind of become a bit desensitised to sort of, you know, people having problems at home or having mental illnesses, but then suddenly having a guy who's created this peculiar god in his head and blinded loads of animals is a bit different and a bit shocking. I think Alan's attitude as well, like the whole singing in court and the general way he seemed to go about being defensive and stuff, was probably very different to how most people would respond in that situation. So I do think that story was, you know, a bit like that case was different to all the others he dealt with. But he does say at the very start,
yeah,
what was Alan but a last straw and a last symbol. So it does suggest that it could be another patient.
He's very stressed, isn't he, at the start of the play as well.
He's very stressed, and he talks about being dissatisfied with his job and just generally not, you know, he doesn't like his, or she doesn't like her husband, because he's sort of the genders. But so he does say, you know, I'm just unhappy with everything in his life. But I do think it would take something pretty significant to actually be the thing that cracks him, her.
Did Alan ever tell us more about Equus? And, like, his beliefs and
stuff. No. I don't think so. No. He never told. The only time his parents ever saw anything was when his dad saw him, when he, like, saw him in his room beating himself. But no, he never tells anyone, because he says, like, nobody knows his name but him and me. And he's scared of telling people about it, which is why it takes him so long to tell Dysart.
Maybe because he likes the fact that it's secret. Because he does have that obsession with secret. Last few questions, okay? So you've got any burning questions? Let's ask them there.
You know when Anne's mum, if she comes to the doctor, like, the first time and tells him some things, and then, like, near the end, she comes back again and is really angry.
Yeah.
What was she angry about? Did she find out about Alan's, like, obsession with Equus or not?
Well, I think she was always probably a bit distraught by the entire situation, because she doesn't like the thought of her son. You know, she talks about her sort of babying him, and she doesn't like the idea that he'd go and do such a violent thing. But when she goes to visit, it says that he threw a tray of food at her.
Okay.
And I think she just, you know, she's kind of feeling really rubbish about it already, and then suddenly he, you know, hurls this at her, and she's kind of like, you have no right to do this, I've not done anything wrong, and she gets really defensive and angry.
Yeah. Right, and you know, Alan's paranoia, his mental turmoil, and when he's pursued by all the guilt, would you argue it's rational or irrational? Like, if you're in his brain set, like, if you're in his mind, if you're in his shoes?
I think it's... Do you mean, like, is his belief rational, or is his fear of... Equus, like, is
both really. Like.
Okay, I think given the sort of series of events that happened to him when he was growing up, it's a fairly rational belief to have sort of come up with. Because in the whole play, kind of, Dysart just finds out little clues that all, if you link them together, it makes sense that this has happened to him. Like, it's not just he went out one day and blinded six horses. So I do think it's a rational fear for him to have ended up with. But I think it would probably take a certain type of human to end up there. Like, I don't think if the same series of events had happened to someone else who maybe just was wired up differently in their head, it might have not happened.
Yeah. Is belief rational or irrational? Mm. Mm. Any questions before we end Karis's bit? No? Can we get Karis clap, please?